have made it to session 15, Multicultural Legacies of the Wild West. This panel will be chaired by Patty Limerick. And Patty really needs no introduction to this crowd. I believe most of us are very familiar with Legacy of Conquest and her subsequent works. I know when I was in grad school, the book had just came out and everyone was talking about this new approach to studying the American West. Now, in her presentation, she noted she didn't really mention Buffalo Bill in Legacy of Conquest, but I do want to share a couple lines from her work that I have found particularly inspiring as I've done my research on Buffalo Bill that I think touches upon it. So I think all you need to do, Patty, is just go back and do one of those little marks underneath and Buffalo Bill. Okay. And we're good. There, and sorry I have the Kindle, I can't give you the print page number, but anyway, this is from Patty's Legacy of Conquest. Acknowledging the moral complexity of Western history does not require us to surrender the mythic power traditionally associated with the region's story, one that I'm sure all of us would agree Buffalo Bill was so instrumental in shaping. By questioning the Westerner's traditional stance as innocent victim, we do not debunk Western history, but enrich it. I can't think of any better way to sum it up. Thank you, Patty.
Thank you.
So that's very cool, because now if somebody ever asked me to sign a book, sign Legacy of Conquest, I can sign my own name, but I will take that page and I will write a little thing that says, this refers to Buffalo Bill Cody in the margins, and that will really make up for injuries of the past. And we search for remedies in our time, and that's a really happy one to have that. So I am here chairing this panel for two reasons, that I am venerable, and this was, Jeremy said a couple of times, that this is to bring established and emerging scholars together. What is striking to me is how very emerged the younger scholars are. The word emerging doesn't seem venerable people. Can we just get together on that? That they're emerged. They're out. They're really there. And it's impressive and dazzling in many, many, many ways. They are answering questions that I did not know how to answer. I did not even know that those were questions to be asked. So if there's any place where the word progress is an embattled one, it is associated with various kinds of myths and distortions. But if you want to see progress, I think the what's going on with younger scholars working in this territory is a very fine place to use the word progress. I was unsettled to go so rapidly myself from being a young Turk to being an established old bird, but I think based on how emerged and how accomplished these young people are, they're gonna make a shift to that order, so prepare yourself. You get treated with deference and you think, why are you doing that to me? I'm very young, so it'll catch up. So Cody, we have had multiple pieces of evidence in his international travels and his international influences and impacts and interactions has positioned us at this conference and in our lives in every dimension for a very expansive set of thoughts and themes and topics to take up. I was chosen for my venerability to chair this. I think I might have been, the committee might have known that I am in fact the most provincial of the established scholars and thereby the one most in need of paying close attention to this session and to many of the others involving international issues. As to what did I know and when did I know it about my provinciality, I did 20 years ago, I did teach a course with the African historian and the Middle Eastern historian, and it was on colonialism and imperialism in the American West, parts of Africa and parts of the Middle East. And that was very stimulating, really enriching. And yet, I will say, as hard as we worked on that course, neither the African historian nor the Middle Eastern historian nor I proposed that we focus a couple of weeks of our course on Buffalo Bill. But what a way to bring these different forms of colonial enterprise and the expansion of Europeans into so many areas and the lasting impact of that. So should we ever revive that class, it will be a very Buffalo Bill-centered class. So I'm going to introduce the first speaker, and this is Didide Gondola, and he is a professor of African history and Africana studies, and this he teaches at IUPUI, which might mystify people who are not as gifted with acronyms as I am, but that is Indiana University, Purdue University. And then there's another I. At Indianapolis. gifted as I am with acronyms. Of course, it's in Indi- I've been there. It's in Indianapolis. That's where it is. He got his PhD in African history from the University of Paris at number seven. He developed his manuscript on the tropical cowboys as a fellow at the Nantes Institute for Advanced Studies in France, and he is now preparing a biography of a person who I very badly need to learn more about because I have no idea who he is, André Matsois-Grenard. Well, I can't wait. I'll be a better person for having read that. He'll be speaking to us today on Buffalo Bill Cody in Kinshasa, Westerns, Violence, and Masculinity in the Heart of the Tropics.
Thank you very much. I just would like to join the bandwagon and thank the people who have invited us. And can you hear me well? Can you hear me? Tilted a little bit. Can you hear me now? Okay, as I was saying, I would like to thank the people who have invited us and for the gathering and the stimulating interventions and papers and presentations. And I'm really pleased because I've been in Indiana, especially in Indianapolis, for 16 years now. The farthest I have driven was Urbana-Champaign, Illinois, and it took this symposium to basically have me drive beyond Illinois and come to Wyoming. So the drive was extremely nice, just really loved it. So I'd like to thank the organizers, of course, and especially because I'm going to be also presenting a longer version of this paper tomorrow. Patty, thank you very much for the introduction. How did you say young emergence scholars? It's the young part that's really nice to me, you know. Thank you very much. The rest doesn't really matter. It's the young part. So a disclaimer here, I am not a Buffalo Bill studies specialist, and I feel a little bit like an interloper here. I'm an African historian. I really like very much popular cultures, and I have actually built my reputation in the field by doing a lot of work on popular cultures. So what really strikes me the most about Buffalo Bill is his ubiquity. He's on the frontier, and he's on stage, on screen, and dime novels that we've seen at lunch. He's Buffalo Bill, and then he performs Buffalo Bill. He does it in America. He does it in Europe as well. He bills himself as an educator, and he's, of course, an entertainer who kind of reenacts a sort of frontier fiction on stage and later on screen. He's also a very savvy businessman who cuts deals left and right to promote his show. He has been celebrated by politicians, by president, by princes, by poets, as well as by paupers. Now, when Buffalo Bill arrived in Kinshasa, which is the capital of the Democratic Republic of Congo today, but back then it was a Belgian colony. So Buffalo Bill arrived there in the 1950s as a cowboy and as kind of the epitome of manhood and masculinity. He kind of immediately captured the attention of young people in Kinshasa who became kind of enamored with the idea of the American West that Buffalo Bill embodied. But before I show you how Buffalo Bill arrived in Kinshasa in the 1950s, and as I said, captured the imagination of those young people that were pretty much marginalized by the colonial situation in the Belgian Congo in the 1950s, and how he became kind of the eponymous hero to a large number of marginalized young people there, I would like to survey the scene a little bit, because for some of you, Kinshasa and the Belgian Congo and Central Africa is a little bit of kind of unfamiliar territory. Kinshasa was, back in the 1950s, was actually called Leopoldville, and it got the name Leopoldville from King Leopold II. This was a very paternalistic colony. It's a colony that was 80 times larger than Belgium, so we're talking about the United States of America east of the Mississippi River. And until 1908, actually, it was not known as the Belgian Congo, but it was called Congo Free State, and it was not even a colony that belonged to a European power. It was the personal, private property of a monarch, and that monarch was Leopold II, and for basically two decades, he held Congo Free State as his personal and private property, but never actually set foot there. You have probably heard about red rubber. You know, today we talk about red diamond, red coltan. Back then it was called red diamond, red rubber. There's one historian, I mean, I should be here promoting my book, but I'm gonna be promoting the book of another person. Have you heard of Adam Hochschild? Back in 1998, he wrote a very interesting book that's called King Leopold II. If you are interested in that time period and the Belgian Congo, read that book. It's a fascinating account of red rubber that took place in the Belgian Congo or in the Congo Free State until 1908. So 1908, there's a transition, okay? So the place is renamed the Belgian Congo. It's now the colony, a colony belonging to a European power, and that power is Belgium. And what the Belgians did was to stop wanton violence that was taking place during the reign of terror that Leopold II imposed upon the country, the place. To some degree, there was some semblance of rule of law that the Belgians established. However, what did not disappear in the transition from Free Congo State, Congo Free State to the Belgian Congo was paternalism. And paternalism really became the hallmark of Belgian colonization in Congo. This was a sort of Hegelian notion or trope that the Congolese man was a big child. That colonization was, you are very familiar with that, was the white man's burden, his God-given mission to rescue the Africans from the clutches of savagery, to domesticate their space, not just their space, but their bodies and their minds as well. Now, since the Congolese were basically essentialized as big children, you can imagine that the people, the group of people that was entrusted to carry out the civilizing mission were actually the white Catholic missionaries, because they had something to teach. They had the Bible. And in addition to kind of evangelizing, they founded hospitals, schools, and in keeping with the holistic ideology of mens sana in corpore sano, a sound body in a sound mind in a sound body, they also organized Boy Scouting, brass bands, and ran all sports activities in the colony. So there was yet another area where Belgian Catholic missionaries' salvific intervention deployed, and this area was filmmaking. So very quickly, those Belgian missionaries realized that films could do a few things for them. The first thing it could do was to easily appeal to African audiences, a wider audience, especially a younger audience. They also were thinking that those films could spread the educational schemes that had until then been limited to religious, school, and training programs. So they started out first with Charlie Chaplin's silent comic shows and Tarzan movies. And those films, they thought, could easily appeal to the African audience, you know, because they took place in the jungle, especially for the Tarzan movies, you know, lots of animals, large animals. The plot was fairly simple, so those African audience would actually love that. And those movies, too, could easily pass the very rigorous Belgian Colonial Belgian Censorship Commission. So the first two movies, you know, kind of genres, you know, coming from Hollywood, coming from America, were the Charlie Chaplin's silent comic shows and Tarzan movies. Then Buffalo Bill came to Kinshasa. And one single movie did it, and that movie is called Pony Express, which starred, for those of you, I know most of you are familiar with this movie, Charlton Heston as Buffalo Bill. It was released in US theaters in 1953. It was dubbed in French the following year as Le Triomphe de Buffalo Bill, and it arrived in Kinshasa around late 1954, early 1955. Now, Pony Express did not arrive alone in Kinshasa in the 1950s, in the middle of the 1950s. It arrived with another movie, and that movie is called in the English, the American version is called The Lone Ranger. So every time I would ask my informants, what was the quintessential movie, you know, that you guys were watching? Because I know that your culture, your movement actually came out as kind of this experience of viewing those movies. They would always mention Pony Express and The Lone Ranger. As a matter of fact, The Lone Ranger was translated into French as Les Justiciers du Far West. And in the process of doing my research on The Lone Ranger, I actually found that the original version of The Lone Ranger in 1933, it was actually a radio show, was actually adapted, or the Lone Ranger is himself was inspired by this American Far West hero by the name of Bass Reeves, who was a U.S. Deputy Marshal, you know, and he kind of inspired the Lone Ranger, and from the radio show, the Lone Ranger became a TV show. I just want to give you an idea of how those young people were watching those movies. Let me just give you a quote here. As soon as projection starts, the crowd, this is from one of my informants, as soon as projection starts, the crowd gets spun into a frenzy. At the first apparition of the cowboy, a deluge of applauses and an explosion of deafening voices and whistles fill the room. The film dialogues are drowned out by the screams of vociferous spectators standing on their feet, asking for more violent action. Some climb on top of their seats, clench their fists, and lash out at imaginary opponents. So young people would actually watch the same movie over and over, and they would come back the next show as kind of self-appointed commentators and spoilers, you know, for the people who were watching the film for the very first time. And my informants were telling me that this was worse than going to watch a soccer game. We could not hear anything. So action is really what mattered to them, not the dialogues. And so what those young viewers in Kinshasa did, especially in Kinshasa's townships, was to parlay their vision of the American Far West from the screen to the street, creating in the process a very unique hybrid blend that conflated the Hollywood version of the drifting cowboy with local elements of manhood. They fashioned township gangs after frontier posses. So those young people, they dubbed themselves the Bills, of course, after the hero, Buffalo Bill. And that term, they would use that interchangeably with Yankee. So Bill, Yankee, the very same thing. Each township in Kinshasa had its own gang of Bills that policed the neighborhood, prevented other gangs from encroaching on their township, deterred younger children from skipping school and girls from wandering outside of the township. They also adopted nicknames from the repertoire of Westerns and other movies, and they fought fiercely over those names, just like Cody Buffalo Bill himself did. He fought fiercely to retain the name Buffalo Bill. In my research, I have come across only one Indian name, and that name is not even the name of a real Indian person. It's the name of an Indian tribe, Apache. The Bills rooted for the cowboys, and they identify themselves with the cowboys rather than with the Indians, although just like the Indians, they were also oppressed, you know, by the colonial situation. In this regard, these young moviegoers conformed to what Hollywood Westerns attempted to convey. They related to Indians with little sympathy, just as Hollywood expected of viewers. Indians were the losers, they were the zeros. Cowboys were the winners, they were the heroes. Now, to be a cowboy or a Yankee or a Bill or a tough guy in Kinshasa in the 1950s and in the 1960s, one had to engage in several performative rituals. The first one is called Kintulu. It's bodybuilding. Very important. It really figured prominently as a badge of masculinity, especially as it intersected with notions of courtship, seduction, and sex appeal. Since so much of their gang activities revolved around fighting over turfs, over girls, over nicknames, monikers, Bill did not just rely on bodybuilding and martial arts, but also on magical rituals known as camo. And this procedure actually included minor incisions on the wrists, the feet, the temples, then a mixture of burnt powder containing animal skin, hide, bones, claws, blood, and teeth would be applied to the open wound. It gave them really kind of a lot of strength, they claimed. Stories are just really unbelievable. They told me that some of them actually, before they go through the process of the procedure, they would bring razor blades. The camo master, after he cuts the camo, would break bottles on their heads, and they would chew the broken bottles. They would eat and chew the blades and swallow them, and nothing would happen to them. I have tons of stories like that. And I would also ask people who were not Bills, did you witness some of those rituals? They said, yes, yes. I mean, we saw them swallowing glasses and entering into trance and head-butting trees, you know? It was just really incredible. Because obviously some of these activities also were deviant, of course, and criminalized because they would smoke marijuana too, and I don't have time to go through that. They developed also their own language, and guess what was the name of that language? Indubil, right? Indubil, which is a kind of a combination between Indian, not the Indians, but the Indian hemp, the marijuana they were smoking, and Bill, Buffalo Bill. And very interesting, their language. I have looked at that, examined that, studied that, at least especially the vocabulary. 50% of Indubil vocabulary dealt with drug consumption in girls. All the terms on the slide that you can see there were pretty ecumenical, you know, meaning that all gang members in Kinshasa, regardless of the township in which they lived, actually used the argot. But there were other terms that were parochial and circulated only within a close-knit township and not beyond. One of the reasons why I was so much interested in this group of young people in Kinshasa was also because of their contribution to basically the decolonization process and movement in the Belgian Congo in the late 1950s and early 1960s. They were very instrumental in spreading the violence in Kinshasa when there was this massive insurrection in January 1959. The Bills, because of the fact that they knew the geography of the place, were able to kind of make the violence spread throughout the townships and basically contribute to colonization in Congo. Now, I just want to conclude, because I'm running out of time, with the end of the movement, the end of the Bill movement. It happened around 1961, 1962 for two reasons. One reason is that in 1960, this Mobutu, who was dictator of the new country, the new independent country, until basically 1997, so he was in power from 1960 all the way to 1997, and he wanted to control all the youth movement. So for him, the Bills were some kind of a loose cannons, and he wanted to co-opt them and use them into his new regime. Okay, because also the fact that he knew that the Bills had a very vast knowledge of Kinshasa, the capital city, so he really wanted to control them. The other reason why the movement ended was because of this Belgian missionary who came to Congo in 1957. His name is Joseph Dalat, very interesting person that I had the privilege to interview and to talk with in 2005, and he died in 2009, unfortunately. He was kind of a maverick missionary. He arrived in Kinshasa, as I said, in 1957 and befriended many Bills. He learned Indubil, preached the gospel in Indubil. Can you believe that? A white missionary from Belgium. He told me that he even wanted to translate the Bible into Indubil, but you know, the vocabulary was just way too limited. He even smoked marijuana with some of the Bills. So very gradually he attracted the Bills to a youth center that he set up in his parish in the heart of Kinshasa's tropical west, and he called it Le Chateau, you know, the castle. The center had a bakery, a restaurant, and young Bills were trained in different trades. They loved him so much that they gave him a name. He became Père Buffalo, Father Buffalo. So he really kind of went beyond the call of duty. He provided the Bills with an outlet to express themselves. He created a makeshift magazine called Esprit de la Jeunesse, the Spirit of Youth, that I really used for my research. And Esprit de la Jeunesse widely circulated in Kinshasa and contributed to the kind of standardization of Indubil. But of course, his real objective was to bring the Bills back to the Catholic fold. And he managed to do that by creating a sort of muscular Christian ethos and the notion of the true Bill. One day, I'm concluding now, before he started his homily, he asked the Bills who they thought a true Bill was. The question was met with silence. Jesus Christ, he said, was the true Bill. Then he proceeded to use the story of Jesus whipping and throwing out the money changers. That's in chapter John, in the second chapter of the book of John, as an example of justified violence to enforce justice. He created a genealogy in which Jesus figured as the ancestor of the Bills' brotherhood. Many Bills took advantage of this end of empire in the 1960s to transition into several careers. Some became musicians, soccer players, others became army officers, politicians, and businessmen. Yet they remained Bills at heart, always striving not to be good men, but to be good at being men. Thank you very much.
Well, now, of course, most of that was familiar to us. Ho, ho, ho. Everyone's supposed to laugh heartily at that. Good heavens, what a fresh glimpse of the world